everyone. Welcome back. I'm here with Megan Brewster. Megan recently completed 2 years at the White House Office of Science and Technology Policy, and she's a former fellow and senior policy advisor for advanced manufacturing. She also has a PhD in MIT on materials sciences. Thanks so much for being here, Megan.
Thanks for having me. I'm thrilled.
So a question we need to start with is the elephant in the room, which is that the two words innovation and government are not always in the same sentence in a good way.
Yeah.
So what are some misconceptions that people have when it comes to science, technology, and the government and innovation?
Yeah, I think one of the most important things to remember about science and government is that that is a symbiotic bi-directional relationship. Science and government are necessary partners. They have been for decades and they will continue to be. You think about the role of government in the scientific enterprise. Government has the ability to set these hairy, audacious goals, like the original moonshot, like
yes.
We are going to the moon. That took all of the brightest minds across the country to come together and make that happen. It was a high impact goal set by the government and carried out in part by scientists and engineers around the country, in addition to a number of other fields that strongly supported us getting to the moon. And the government has a number of strong innovators across the federal government. And one of the things I think that's really exciting right now about government, and you think about innovation in government, is that people from across the country have the ability to cycle in and come do a tour of duty in government. So you don't need to completely give up your job. You can come as a scientist, like I did, for a year or a couple of years. You can come in, serve, make a difference, and then you can go back to your day job. And so the government has been able to attract some of the brightest minds across the country through these tours of duty.
That's fascinating. Yeah, can you talk to me a bit about your experience as a scientist who worked in the government?
Yeah,
in the White House?
Of course. So my interest in science policy started when I was in graduate school. I was doing research in the lab, and the research was funded by the National Science Foundation. So the NSF is one of the federal agencies, one of the many federal agencies that funds R&D across the country. And by R&D, I'm referring to research and development. And I wondered, why is it that the NSF is funding me and this specific project? And then more broadly, who sets the R&D agenda for our country? Who makes those decisions? And so I developed this strong interest in science policy and agenda setting for research and development across America. And so it culminated with me going to Washington and doing my tour of duty, which put me at the White House Office of Science and Technology Policy.
And so I think public policy and how it impacts technology, I think sometimes people who are outside of the government, it sounds a bit distant. Is there a way you can kind of explain how public policy impacts technology?
Yeah, exactly. And I think, as I mentioned when we first started, is that it's a bi-directional relationship. So science influences policy and policy influences science. And it's important that that relationship be symbiotic in that way. So an example of where policy influences science is kind of like what I just mentioned, where in some cases policy is funding R&D. So we're trying not to choose specific winners and losers. You try to choose general fields where there's R&D dollars. So for example, the Materials Genome Initiative or the National Nanotechnology Initiative, or the one that I worked on primarily was the Advanced Manufacturing Initiative, where we set out, $1 billion of federal funds for cutting edge R&D in advanced manufacturing. And that has resulted in these Manufacturing USA Institutes. So that's an example of where policy supports science. An example of where science supports policy could be, for example, the climate modeling to tell us what is happening to our atmosphere as humans continue to, live and work and play on Earth. And those models and projections inform many of the greenhouse gas emission goal setting that our government signs up for, either internally or through these world agreements, like the Paris Climate Agreement. So those goals are set by governments, but they are based on these climate models.
It's fascinating. And so With manufacturing in the U.S., which is a huge topic here at Exponential Manufacturing, what is a concern that you have right now?
Yeah, so one of the things that I'm really excited about with manufacturing in the United States is that the U.S. is, you know, inherently innovative. We have that entrepreneurial spirit, and there is so much amazing technology that will transform the way we manufacture things today. It's going to look totally different in the manufacturing floors of tomorrow. And what I would love to see is a transition of the dialogue that we have around manufacturing. You know, maybe we should focus less on the jobs of yesterday, and focus more on reinventing the game, defining the industries of the future, and going out and winning those industries. So in areas like additive manufacturing and 3D printing, like lightweight metals, like power electronics, these are all very exciting areas for manufacturing that are looking to the industries of the future. One of the areas that I'm really excited about is biomanufacturing for regenerative medicine. So can we repair and replace cells, tissues, and organs for civilians as well as for veterans that may have been harmed in duty, to the point of, you know, could we one day be 3D printing organs? That would be life-changing. That would be amazing. I want to see the national dialogue focus on those industries of the future. That's the direction we need to go. We need to invent the game of the future, not try to, you know, compete with other countries and their current at their own games. We need to be thinking forward and leapfrogging into those technologies of the future.
I love how you say like the technologies of the future or like the industries of the future. I think there is a real like clinging to the past. It's comfortable to stick with what's comfortable. Yeah. And I think sometimes when people talk about automation or like collaborative robots, etc. Yes, they will take jobs, and I think we have to be very realistic about that. At the same time, I think we do also have to be responsibly forward-thinking.
Yes. Yeah, I agree. And, you know, I think that there's still a wide-ranging debate and a lot of research to really understand the nuances of the effect of technology on jobs. There is job destruction. There's also job creation, but that job creation may be in a different part of the value chain. And so while it's easy to transition those jobs, it's not easy to transition the people who fill those jobs. They need to be upskilled. In some cases, they need new training, and that's that takes time, that takes energy, and it takes a very important support structure. Mm-hmm. So I do think it's very important to have that dialogue early and engage, you know, not just STEM practitioners, not just the scientists, engineers, technologists, and mathematicians, but folks from across all fields. Right before we went on the air, you and I were talking about grand challenges for engineering. And I think it's really important to define, you know, what are those big, hairy, audacious challenges of our life? How will we map the brain? How will we make clean drinking water available to the world? These are engineering challenges, but they will require active dialogue with a variety of other disciplines so that we can be responsibly innovating in the future.
Completely. And it's John Hagel was here earlier talking about the importance of, with innovation, you need a diverse type of people and minds and ideas at the table. And I think that's so true. Like with the grand challenges of our world, we need people who are not just technologists. We need people thinking about ethics and creativity and all of those areas.
The grand challenges are really exciting because they captivate the imagination of the entire country. And they bring together just this amazing conversation of you know, a number of voices. And one of the things that we found is that through grand challenges, you have a group of solvers that tend to look a little bit more like America. You know, we have people from across the country. We have a variety of demographics that want to engage in this conversation. They see how, you know, being a part of the dialogue is really going to change not just their world, but for all of us and make it a better place. And so that's one of the reasons why I'm really excited about talking about engineering and the future of manufacturing couched in the framing of these grand challenges.
Definitely with this wider audience. And so what are some opportunities you see for applying these accelerating technologies into the use of technology in the government?
Yeah, so I think that, you know, a lot of these advanced technologies are going to impact all of America. Yeah. And when you have impact at that scale, you have to interact with the federal government. The federal government is going to play some kind of role. So there are a lot of amazing men and women in the federal government that are innovators, they are scientists, and they are very excited about helping these fields grow. And it's important to have the alignment between the new technologies coming out mm-hmm. and the regulatory science that goes along with it. So in one example, FDA, the Food and Drug Administration, just recently approved the first 3D printed pharmaceutical. I mean, that is a huge technology innovation, and it's a great example of where FDA scientists at the FDA worked with the innovators and the drug company that wanted to do this, and they developed the regulatory science side by side as that pharmaceutical is being developed. And that's the sort of that's the sort of dialogue that we need to have.
Collaboration.
With these exponential technologies, things are going to be moving really fast. We need to make sure that, we have safe and responsible innovation moving forward. And having that early dialogue with government is very important because government is innovating at the same time.
I completely, completely agree. And so as a scientist and someone involved in government, do you have a call to action for any civically engaged entrepreneurs or really anyone out there?
Yeah, I think it's very important to stay engaged in the discussion. The government, the federal government is, in some ways only as good as the people that work in it. And so we all need to have that sense of service that we are a part of that dialogue and we are part of that conversation. And there are so many ways to enter that dialogue. It could be as simple as calling your member of Congress and letting them know how you feel about different issues that affect your life. It could be all the way to, signing up for one of these fellowships. That's a tour of duty to DC where, scientists and engineers are actually working in the federal government. And the learning goes both ways. So I think it's really important to just stay engaged in that dialogue, to continue to voice your opinions and your views, to be open to constructive criticism, to consider how will you serve. There are so many ways to be a part of the dialogue.
I love that. Consider the ways that you can serve. There's so many ways to be a part of the dialogue. Megan, thank you so much. I appreciate you spending the time here
thank
and everything you.
You
shared and the work that you're doing.
Thank you so much. Appreciate it.
Okay, everyone, stay tuned. In a few minutes, we're going to have some live tech demos and more amazing interviews.